How many of you have heard of the 3 for $30 plan? Raise your hand. All right, good deal, good deal. So we're going to kind of unpack it a little bit. This is the way to kind of think about it. Eric designed what you're seeing here. So it's got a really good design, I think. And the overall goal is reach, train, and give. And we're trying to influence and share the gospel. We're trying to train and give. And I'm going to talk to you about how we came to that and really what all we can do, how we think it might be able to help us as we're trying to spread the gospel. So first, we conducted a SWOT analysis. I encourage all of our agencies, our churches, our different groups to do that. Just start and ask yourself, what are our strengths? What are our weaknesses? What are our opportunities? And what threats do we have? We did it by asking our denominational boards and commission members, all denominational employees, all of our state leaders, and then we asked for input via NAFWB News that comes out every 2 weeks on Thursday. So it was a way to get as many people involved as we could in giving us that information. Then we started looking at that information and developing goals. We started with our agency directors and basically they're thinking about their particular departments, how that fits, but also how it fits for the denomination. Then we farmed that out to our state leaders. Again, we asked for input via the NAFWB News. And you may have heard of the Board of Retirement. They had a program last year or a year ago, this past October, called Reinvest, where some of our younger leaders came in and we just asked them for feedback on the goals, what was written up there. And it got changed a whole lot and turned into what you see there right now. 5 for $5, so some of you have heard of this group. They work with the Titans, it's Mark McPeak's group. They analyze the data, so I will say to you, 1 year ago right now, after the leadership conference, I read every response that came in on the SWOT analysis, every single one of them individually. And I actually started working on that a little bit myself, but Mark McPeak and Casey Pontius of 5 and 5 agency, a change agency, just started looking at that using some of our qualitative software that they have and gave us a lot of valuable information that you'll see. You'll see some of it here in a minute. The number one thing is think about the strengths. So when we ask all of these groups what our strengths were, number one by far was a commitment to doctrine. Number two, true to the Word of God. And then they said community and unity, and then it goes down from there like strong leadership and so forth. But that's a theme, and I will say to you, sometimes in looking at the data, they're looking at what people said was our strength, but also they could use the whole document and they could look at what people also said in the other categories, and sometimes you're going to see some overlap. So there was no doubt about that. People felt very good about our commitment to doctrine and where we're at as a group. Then you keep going and you ask people, you know, what are some of the weaknesses that we are experiencing? Let me show you this first. So here's an example. So someone said a historic commitment of Free Will Baptist to the Bible and the doctrines alive and well. Now, some of the questions we're asking is, what are we doing to make sure that that is guarded and passed from this generation to the next generation? Let's go ahead and look at weaknesses. And so when we came to weaknesses, the number one weakness noted was education and training. Number two was a lack of a shared vision. Now you'll see this is not as strong, but it is a pretty common denominator that came up under weakness, but you'll also see it sometimes under threats, and sometimes they would even start talking about it in other areas. So that this is a strength, but such and such is a weakness, and they would come back and talk about that. You can see other things, lack of resources, unwillingness to change, all the way down to some of the lower things. And basically, you could sum it up like this. They believe our denomination needs to be far more effective in areas of education and training. The lack of these is causing a significant adverse impact with leaders and in churches. So the leaders who participate in the research talk about untrained leaders and pastors. So you hear a lot about we're concerned that our folks don't know our doctrine. We're concerned that they sometimes don't know quite how to reach people and so forth. So that's an overlying area. So they see it as a critical component. It's also the second mentioned opportunity. So this is where I say it mixes. And so folks saw this as an opportunity for us as a denomination to do something about those particular areas. Another thing with weakness that came up over and over, and actually is why we have the 3 for 30 plan, is a lack of a shared vision. So you saw people say we needed a shared vision, talking about it as an area of weakness, but again, it showed up with opportunity. And I'll tell you, we just heard it repeatedly. And you would sometimes hear people say things like, we're autonomous, but we need such and such. And so that's part of why we have 3 for 30. It's an outgrowth of people saying, we want all of our departments, we want our states, we want our churches to be working towards some things that are common and doing what we can about that. So what about opportunities? So by far, it was the younger generation. And you'll see people talk about things like Truth and Peace and E-Team and so forth. You'll also see that pull back and get into things like we're not training the next generation, like younger adults, as effectively as we could. It is a major second, but it's there, training and education. So even though that was a big weakness, folks saw that as a great opportunity. If we would put an emphasis on training and educating our folks, putting more emphasis on our Free Will Baptist identity and so forth as well. Now, you see here where it kind of comes down to Free Will Baptist leaders believe the denomination is experiencing an unusual time of unity among leaders and churches. So whatever the category, you would see as an overall theme, unity is something that we have now, and it's something that many people said they did not feel we had had in the past. Okay, now they wanted a shared vision and all that, and sometimes they would say many people or many groups sometimes work in silos, but as a theme, folks felt like we were more unified than we've ever been in the past. Yeah, that's something you would see. So you see them talking about this. It's not only is it a strength, it's a blessing that should be cultivated further and how it can attract the right ones. And then they talk about division among leaders is the third most mentioned category of weakness. So you do see that there is still concern there, but as the mood is at the moment, people are feeling we're in a better spot there than we have been for perhaps a long, long time. Now, what are the threats? Number one, by far, cultural hostility. So there's a lot of concern about, you know, what's happening in our culture and how that might impact us, tax-exempt status and those kinds of things. There's also a major concern about a neglecting of Free Will Baptist heritage. And so you can probably see that's one of the things we've gone after a little bit in the seminars that have been selected. Then you see not involving youth, and sometimes you would see younger leaders actually saying that, you're not involving us, you need to involve us more, and those kinds of things. And so those were seen as threats to our denomination. And so the greatest threat, though, that was mentioned was contemporary trends. So whether they're talking about that with the slide in the culture, or whether they're talking about that even with the erosion of a lack of Free Will Baptist identity, you'd kind of see it in both ways, but that's the big thing. Unfriendly, even hostile to Christianity, and they know it's going to be a challenge to negotiate. So they think that that's something that, you know, we really need to focus upon as we move forward. So we took all of that, we studied all of that, we worked at it and started thinking about what that would mean. And then our particular agency, the executive department, really looked at this because they talked about the need to involve our youth, how that's a critical situation. They talked a lot about Truth and Peace and E-Team and how we need to have something like that. We do have something in missions for college students, but perhaps we need something like that overall, even like a Truth and Peace for college students. Some people mentioned that. But there's a lot of concern even for that younger generation. You know, folks coming right out of college or going straight into the ministry. You saw that as a big thing as well. So they proposed, this is the 5x5 people kind of summarizing it, that the executive office can make things better. So hopefully this is true. And that they said that we could do that by fostering unity and by helping with the casting of vision. And so we are trying to work to involve as many of our folks as we can, trying to communicate with them, and also we're trying to help all of our folks work together with a vision, if you will, with a single purpose to address some of the issues that we're experiencing. So, 3 for 30. Why 3 for 30? Well, first off, it's a decade-long focus. So it's the 2020. So I went to a particular state, will not name it, and I was talking about it, and toward the end someone said, I don't get the 30. And I'm like, uh-oh, I have failed. So it means that 2021, all during this decade, we'll be focusing on reach, train, and give. Now you'll notice many of our departments will have like 5-year incremental goals. And so we're thinking, we're really kind of exploring this with our departments, with you, our leaders, and in our various churches. Do we focus 1 year on training? Do we focus another year on reaching and giving? Right now, we're looking at really in 2021, just kind of rolling out and getting people to think about what I'm going to show you in a minute, individually and as churches and associations, and then as denominational agencies. It's not perfect. And so I'm reminded often when I deal with our churches and so forth, and when I dealt with my own church about let's just say, not so great church basketball team I was on once. We called timeout. We were down by 1 point. We had the ball. We were on the sidelines. We didn't have a coach. We're a church basketball team. Who needs one? And so this guy wants to call this play. This guy wants to call this play. And this one wants to have the other one. And by the way, it each involved those particular guys shooting. But anyway, at the end of the timeout, they blow the horn and we don't have a play. And I'm thinking, you know, it really didn't matter. We just need to run a play. And if we had picked one and worked that play, we lost. You know, it would have gone a little differently. So what you're going to see is not perfect. It's not perfect at all. But you and I just need a play. And the play that we're going to talk about is based on the research, some of the research that's out there. It's based on what our folks have said as part of the SWOT analysis, and it's based on what the Scripture says the church and we as individual Christians should be about and should be doing. So it's not perfect, but it is scriptural. So let's talk about it a little bit. We're trying to go at it at 3 levels. And that's why we're asking you to help us to get your folks liking our social media and involved with us with social media, subscribing to our email so they get this bi-weekly stuff. We want them to think as an individual, what can I do to reach? What can I do? Who am I training or discipling? And how am I giving of myself financially and wholly and my gifts and everything else? So we're always talking individually. We're also talking as from churches and associations. So as a church, we're hoping, when I was a pastor, we would have goals for the year. And so we're hoping that churches will adopt particular goals on reaching particular groups, training and discipling certain groups, and giving in certain ways. We think that'll help us. We also think some of these goals will be hard for one church to do, but maybe whole associations could do that. And then our agencies and us as a denomination will have goals as well with under reach, train, and give. And just to get that really quick, notice that some of our agencies kind of gravitate a little bit more towards some of these areas like IM and NAM with reach. However, if you listen to, Dr. Gilliland gave the report at the general meeting this past July, you'll notice that their goals for the next 5 years actually broke down. They broke them down into reach, train, give. So they're primary, they're kind of a reaching group that they have goals in each particular area that are out there. So let's talk about reach and what we mean. So first off, Psalm 43 says, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me into your holy hill and to your dwelling. So when we say reach, we mean reach individuals for Jesus Christ, but we're also talking as a group about having an impact on our communities, okay? So our folks are concerned about hostility of the culture toward them. Cool, embrace it, and actually impact it or reach it. I don't know if you've read this book, How Christianity Changed the World, but it's pretty cool. And even in a place like Europe where it's, you know, less Christian today, you can see the impact of Christianity. We enjoy the impact of Christianity in the United States, even though, you know, we're becoming a more secular place. So that's what we're getting at. Your community is different because your church is in your community. Okay, that's a church / association goal. Your workplace, your school, your neighborhood, your family is different because you are in that space. So that's more of the individual type goals. So what we're going to try to help us to think about is how I am salt and light when I move in an environment, and individual Christians thinking about that as they, and it helps them to reach their neighborhoods, reach their family, and so forth. It is the idea, you know, William Wilberforce and the influence he had upon slavery in England. And you can probably see, if you've been watching the Better Together podcast or listening to them, you can get elements of that. So if you saw the one with Dr. Paul Harrison, where we talked about untold consequences, it was both a One Magazine article and it was a Better Together podcast. And so what he's talking about is how we impact, kind of like what Jim McComas did in that seminar earlier today, we impact those around us and how that changes the environment and so forth. And that's part of what we're wanting to do. But we mean reach by getting the gospel to people, them getting saved, baptized, discipled, and so forth. We mean that as well. So the scripture says, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel. So right now, when you think about North America, United States and Canada especially, when you think about us, we are a group, we have the nuns, those who believe in nothing in particular, they're vastly growing. And so this is Pew Research here showing you from, it went in 07 from 35.6 to 55.8. Now they admit that's an estimate, but it's a pretty good estimate. And so what they're showing you is the nuns are just exploding. And so what we want our folks to do is think about how they can reach nuns, those who believe in nothing in particular. And I'm going to tell you secretly, they're a very good group to reach. I think we can reach them because there's different reasons for why people become nuns. And so here's a breakdown. This is also from Pew about who they are. Atheist, agnostic, you know, and just people that have a hodgepodge of various beliefs. And we're kind of wanting to be like what you see in Acts 26. To help people open their eyes that they may turn from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness. So I've interacted with a lot of nuns. In fact, I would say more of them than Christians on a day in and day out basis until I went to work for the National Association of Real Baptists. I need to clarify that, right? All right. And so I feel like I know a lot of, well, I do. I know them. And some of them are nuns because they just came to that, you know. The majority of them, it was kind of a hit and miss, if anything, with church. There are some that just actively rejected. They actually, a lot of them came from bad churches, just be frank with you. And then some of them just never knew. And I also pastored a church. I pastored a church for 19 years and 2 months and 2 days. No, I'm kidding. But anyway, you know, 19 years, 2 months. And in my new member class, sometimes I had nuns who'd become believers. Sometimes I'd have people that were believers, but they had come from this background or that background. Give me a nun any day. Any day. Sometimes in a new member class, I would have to kind of say, well, you know, that's great that you believe that, but this is what we believe as a church, and we're not changing. You know, we're not changing for you. A nun who gets saved comes in and says, what do we believe? Show it to me in the Bible. Okay, so sometimes I think when we look at what's happening with the nuns, we get worried. What I'm going to say to you is it's a harvest that's just saying, please come to me. And I believe we as a group need to think. Now, you've got to act and interact differently to reach them, but I believe we can do it. The other thing is, Acts 1:8, and many of you have heard me talk about this. The morning I walked down, I read a certain passage that morning, early that morning. I was at work, and I walked down and realized Acts 1:8 has come to me. Everybody, it seemed like, you know, a third of people from somewhere else. And so that is the case in a lot of our cities and a lot of our places, and it will increasingly be so. So notice this data. Again, this is Pew. I love Pew. 9.6, 1965, estimated by 2065, 78.2. That's a ways off. But look at 2015, 44.9. Now, a lot of people get upset by that. They don't like it that a lot of people from other countries are coming. But I assure you, on a college campus, they're the most likely to listen to your presentation to the gospel. Hear me when I say that. They respond when we work with them. A particular country that we had a relationship with, I think every person from that country has become a Christian. Okay, and that's just from professors inviting them over for Christmas, Thanksgiving, they can't go home. They are a harvest that's just dying for people to interact with them. All you got to do is take them home for Christmas, take them to a couple of services, do some meals, love them. And they just seem to like, they fall in love with Jesus. Now I know I made it simple, but in some ways it is. And so as we think about this, I think every individual needs to go to their workplace and they need to look at that and they need to see it. And they need to be thinking about that. And then thinking about how they can reach these folks and think about how their culture is different, but that creates an opportunity for you. If you're a church, if you're close to a college, I beg you, interact with the college. Do what you can to work with some of those international students. They have nowhere to go, okay? And think about if you watched what happened with COVID, can we come? Can we? I mean, it's been a mess. So it creates opportunities if you're a church or you've got associations to think about that and what you can do. Look at where they're coming from, and so you probably are getting a sense of why we're putting so much emphasis on Spanish. If you look at some of that data, look at where people who've been abused, the refugees, look at where they're coming from as well. And I do come back to this because this is where you're going to get them. Most of them they're coming from work, number one. Number two is family. Number three, school. That's why your schools are great places. They're making a lot of changes in their lives. They've come from some difficult situations, and if you don't get to them, somebody else is, and it's a different kind of outcome. So what we're asking folks to do is have an individual goal, and here's how an individual goal goes. I will reach blank with the gospel. So this year, I'm targeting Uncle Sam, neighbor James, coworker Cynthia, you know, whatever. That's my individual goal, like in a church situation. Now, a church or association may go after a particular group, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about that in a minute, with the gospel. As a denomination, what we're trying to do, and we're already trying to do this, is we're trying to train our people to reach these groups. So notice Pedro and Pontius, Aaron, you know, that was going after kind of the nuns a bit. If you'll notice the seminar, one of the first ones this morning, the urban deal with Jose, that's already pointing in this particular direction of thinking about that. We're trying to do it through the Better Together podcast, just straight up. That's the backhanded goal of that. There's a lot of multi-layer goals we're doing, but that's one of the things we're trying to do and emphasize there. And if you'll notice, we're showing how to go after a particular group. So here's Detective Hodges, good fellow, well trained by some good parents here. So he talks about how hard it is to be a police officer. Talks about working the riots in Nashville, Tennessee. Talks about what churches have done, how they would bring the wet wipes, and you know, it helps with things people threw on them and all that, how they had food that churches brought to them. And he even gives an example about he and his partner sitting in a restaurant. Somebody comes over and says, could we pray for you all? His partner says, what was that all about? And he shares the gospel with him. Okay? So if you watch that, you know how to reach police officers. Plain and simple. All you got to do is watch it. I think it's like 22 minutes. He did on vacation. Over here, Stephen Campbell. Stephen Campbell went to my church 8:30 in the morning, went from Clayton, North Carolina to Walter Reed Hospital. Had to be there by like, I forget, 5 o'clock, it always got jammed up going around. He works with active duty personnel right now. Now, he's sent, well, he tells you on here, he's now in Fort Bragg. So what Stephen is doing is, every day he's working with people, with guys at Walter Reed that had been hurt often, now people that are being trained. He tells you, this is what you need to do for that active duty personnel if you're around a military base. This is what you need to be doing for their families, for these active duty guys, how you can help them. Gary Curry, Oklahoma folks, you need to raise your hand. You know Gary, he's the man. Talks about ministering in prisons. And this is one of my professors that I hired at NCCU, Tahira Blunt. It's interesting. She talks about the ministry as she was a kid, Free Will Baptist head to her community. But really what she's explaining there is, this is how you can have an impact on schools. You can reach schools and so forth. So if you'll keep watching, you'll notice we tend to have a podcast and we tend to have like one of these graphics that go along with it. So we're tying together. Okay, you can listen to Detective Hodges. And then you can think about how we can serve servants, but it's pushing you in the direction of how you can reach them. So as a denomination, that's what we're doing. So your church decides we're going to reach police officers, or we're going to reach active duty personnel. We're trying to provide you resources so that you can do that. Maybe your church is small, but you're like, we've got Fort Bragg in our area, or, you know, hypothetically, if someone were close to Walter Reed or whatever, you know, we're going to do this as an association of churches to try to reach them and help them. Another part of, with the reach goal is, this comes back to denomination, we make no bones about it. We want to see an increase in Hispanics, Spanish-speaking folks, in our services and our churches. One out of four Generation Z folks are of Hispanic, Latino origin. And so that's the point of this Facebook page. If you'll notice, we're mirroring what we do on the English side. So so anyway, it's just kind of going at that. All right, that's the reach part. Let's talk about training for a minute. So individually, we want to, first off, training, we do want them to think individually. Training your family, and think about how D6, Randall House has emphasized D6 discipleship. We want to emphasize discipleship, personal discipleship. I should be discipling someone in my community, a neighbor, a coworker, someone at my church, and so forth. And then we make no bones about it. Everybody is called. And so every individual should be learning something every day to help them to be a more effective Christian. And they should also be teaching someone, discipling someone. Every church should have a discipleship focus and a training focus. And then we too as a denomination. So let's just look at this for a minute. There's two things I want you to pick up here. First off, look at the generations. Look at how they fall down. And we're going to try to encourage our churches to think about what generation folks are from. And so what you do with Generation Z is different than millennials and different than Generation X and baby boomers, silent generation, so forth. We want them to have discipleship activities for each group. Now this is, you know, we've done that for many years, Sunday school, right? But we do want folks to think that, how am I discipling the children? You know, it's really D6, is really. We want them to think that way, but we also want them to think about what's happening with the Hispanic population. So I mentioned that a moment ago, one out of every four of Generation Z, Hispanic. So we want to plan. The kids speak English. The parents, some of them speak English, but they want their kids to speak English. Opportunity, just lots of opportunity for us. We want them to think that way. But business as usual will not cut it. This is the most educated generation our nation's ever seen. Now, when we say education, we mean college education. And so that's sometimes some indoctrination and so forth. But what it means is you have to have answers. You, when someone asks you how you know the Bible's true, you can't just say it's because it says so. You better have an answer. Yeah. When people are like, well, don't all roads lead to heaven? Our people have to almost a second just come back and say, well, you know, that doesn't make sense. Does I-40 lead to New York, or, you know, it goes to California, but I don't, all roads, that doesn't make sense. We want them to just have comments and be able to engage people, because you've got to be able to do that. So, individual goals, I personally am going to train or disciple blank in the Christian faith. I'm going after this person. Now, we want them to start with their kids, their grandkids, their nieces, their nephews, discipling them. We want them to think about a neighbor. We want them to think about someone within their own church. But if you are a Christian, you are supposed to win people to the Lord and disciple people in the faith. And so we want all of our individual Free Will Baptists to think, all right, I'm going after this one. I'm praying for them every day, and I'm trying to think of, I'm inviting them to this, and I'm talking to them about this. Okay, I'm trying to reach them, and I'm discipling this person. I'm meeting with them, you know, every week or every month or whatever, but I am actively engaged in discipling this person. We want churches and associations to train our people and our lay people to use their spiritual gifts. I hope by the time I'm done with this, everyone knows their DISC profile. Everyone knows their MBTI code. Now you say, that's not spiritual. Have you ever read Psalm 139? You're fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works. That gets down to your DNA, okay? So if you're an extrovert, God made you an extrovert. Now, sometimes we want you to stretch and not talk all the time to meetings and so forth. But anyway, if you're an introvert, God made you that way. You need to know how you were made, what you were made to be, and go and do it, whether it be a pastor or layperson. When you get in your zone, you're more effective. So we want people to know what their gifts are, to know what they've been made to be, and we want them to go and do it. We don't want them to go in this, well, this person was like this, so I'm supposed to be like this. No, who are you? Who did God made you? He put you here for a reason to do something. We want them to go forth and do it. And then as denominational goals, so we want to have assessment centers. So we're already trying to do this with our refresh part, some of the stuff that Dr. Ransom has done in the past with church planners. We're hoping we can offer that to any pastor that would want that. I'm doing some senior retreats and so forth. I'm going to give them the DISC, right? We're going to do what we can to help them figure out, this is what I've got. This is the skill sets, Matthew 25, the talents that God's given me. How can I take those and use those? So we want to train people in that. That's what we're trying to do as a denomination. We want every individual to know, who am I, what am I made to do, and to go forth and do it. Now, as another aspect of that, as a church, churches are different. So what is my church uniquely positioned to do, you know, and then training within that to go and accomplish that. So we've done a bit of that. Some of you went to Pedro and Aaron's seminar today. If you listen in on, I think we've done two podcasts with him. That's training people about, okay, this is how we reach nuns. This is how we reach atheists, you know, a former atheist, now a believer. The training also gets into the part where people ask about us leaving the doctrine behind. So you've probably seen the You and Your Church that we put out by Dr. Piccirilli. We've got another little resource like that we hope to have out at the National. So that's just, we are doubling down on our theology, okay? So, and our practices. So we'll have things like that. And just as an aside, if you've ever worked in a secular environment, our theology comes off pretty good, if you think about it. We believe Jesus died for everyone, you know, not just a hand, you know, not and so forth. Just walk through. And even the things that everybody's embarrassed about, not you, of course, but some people are embarrassed about feet washing. Talk about some of Generation Z about feet washing. Well, of course you would do that. It's in the Bible, isn't it? Now, they don't know it's in the Bible, but you tell them it is. And then they'll do it, right? Or they think it's good. Brad's here talking about... he's talking about greeting there. And here is David talking about how you train parents to be coaches. So that's what we're trying to do to help folks individually go and do those things, which you could also do with churches and associations and so forth. I don't know if you've seen, these are the refresh resources at YouTube, but I mentioned a little bit about Brad and the whole assessment deal. If you look at some of the webinars that we've done with him, we walk you through that. You know, now we're doing it to pastors, right? Figure out your DISC profile, figure out, you know, how do you do a conflict, those kinds of things. But we're trying to do that down the, you know, all the way down the road where it could even be for individuals, so forth. Got to hurry. Okay. And then as a denomination, you know, that's going at, you know, where we're trying to provide for that. How many of you participated in Jeremiah 29? Raise your hand. All right, good deal. So that secretly was a pilot approach at this. That was an attempt to see if we can do a mass, you know, training with denomination, you know, denomination-wise. So basically, by the way, it could be used at any time. The resources are there. They're at NAFWB.org. They're at the Facebook site. So we ask people, read your Bible every day. What's the timeless principle? What did it mean to the original hearers? What's it teach you about God? What do you need to do about it? So we focus first on reading the Bible. You know, had the little reading sheet, English and Spanish. Went through it, had the little vlogs, if you will, video blogs. Had the scripture readings and so forth. And we had these graphics that went out that addressed that particular that issue of the week. You have from us a commitment. Every Tuesday, well, first, every Monday at 8 a.m. Central, we drop a podcast. Like it, share it. You've got something you can put on your own site, your Facebook sites. By the way, your logarithm, if you the more you post or share, the more likes, I mean, the more exposure you get. We give you something Monday. We give you something Tuesday. This is Tuesday's 8 a.m. Central. We send out these little I call them memes. But anyway, these little pictures here. Wednesdays during Jeremiah 29, we put out these blogs so you could see it or you could hear it. There's where you could read it. And on Thursdays, 8 a.m. Central, we put out a Bible verse or sometimes a Bible paraphrase at 8 a.m. Central. You need to post every day if you've got a church Facebook site. We give you something Monday, Tuesday, Thursday. You post on Friday, you know, that's what we're going to talk about in our service Sunday. You post, you know, on Wednesday, we're going to do such and such tonight, come out and join us. You got something every day, okay? So it's a pretty good deal. So train individual goals, I'll train disciple this person. I've mentioned that, and so, okay, let's do with give. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. To reach the next generation, you've got to serve the next generation. You've got to be doing something that they see as selfless, that you don't get a return from to do it. This is Generation Z. They want an activist government. So forget about that for politics purposes. Think about it for church purposes. They're not into a church that just meets Sunday, you know, maybe a couple of times a week. What are you doing as a church? How are you helping people? Actually, they want to see a church be salt and light. So again, think back about some of the things, the Better Together podcast. There's Chris Davenport talking about some of the things they did to minister during COVID. There is Taylor, the Samaritan's Purse Disaster Relief Coordinator, talking about what you can do to help people in a disaster. Talks about Master's Men, what our guys have done and gals have done as well. And here is Barry Porter, a buddy of mine, head of the Red Cross, the disaster relief aspect. Now, when we talked about that, we talked about the hurricanes, okay? However, if you listen to the podcast, Barry hits hard fires. You've probably dealt with them with fires. They come to every fire and provide something. So one of the things Red Cross is desperately seeking is churches that would just partner with them to get fire alarms out in the community, and especially rural. Right now, actually, when we did this podcast, they were desperately in need of blood drives because they had a problem with that because of COVID. So we're wanting people to think about giving of their talents, giving of themselves to each other, bearing each other's burdens as they're there in a church, to have individual goals. You know, how am I giving of myself financially? How am I giving of my time? How am I giving my talents? Same for church and associations. You know, we're faithfully serving and so forth by providing meals or engaging in service activities. And I'm going to tell you, if you don't do those kinds of things, some of these folks, these nuns and so forth, you will not reach them. You've got to be, they've got to see that selfless kind of activity, it seems like. Denominational goals. So we're trying to be stewards of resources. And we're trying to, we're trying to train about that. But also, I want you to think a bit about pushing our people and our groups to think about using their finances to the best of their ability. If you've seen this podcast with David Brown, he talks about closing a church the right way. And many of you know about this church. This church is giving so much to their state, so much to IM, so much to NAM. They'll give basically $33,000 to those various entities until Jesus Christ returns. Okay? Now, they did that because they established that was sold and it was put into an endowment. Okay? So we want our people to think about their personal money. We provide resources. We don't want churches to close, but if you do, please do so in a way that the gospel carries on. Your light doesn't go out. You give a one-time gift, that money spent, that's it. But if you know, the endowments, it goes until the Lord returns. So we want to hit that hard. Personally, I think this is an area we as Free Will Baptists want to focus on heavily because I believe this is where it's at. In the university system, we had all kinds of endowments and they changed. It just created all kinds of opportunities. I had faculty members. I never had to worry about anything because their money was supplied. We want to get to a place where we're no longer the servant of the lender. And so part of that is to even get people thinking about that, think about what they do with their money and their resources and all of that. So, you know, we want your feedback on 3 for 30. We want you to tell us ways that you're trying to influence your folks to do it individually. We want your feedback about what your churches are doing. Are they going to adopt or try to approach that? And then we also want your feedback about what you think we as a denomination should be going at and trying. And then we're trying to think about how we can get this out, you know, into the minds and into people's vision to think about how I could do that. We want your feedback there. So just remember to do that. You can always email me at emoody@nafwb.org, or if you forget that, questions@nafwb.org. And let us know what you think. Give us your feedback on that and so forth. Daniel, we're out of time, aren't we? All right, I'm going to say a prayer then, and you can come up and I'll put my mask on. You can come up and ask questions and so forth, but you could also send suggestions or any kind of feedback that you've got. Email it to us. We really want it, and we're going to need it as we try to go forward as a denomination, as individual Christians and as churches, and try to impact our world for the Lord. Father, we thank you for our folks. We thank you for their love and their concern for the people around them. And we just ask you'll help us to be able to effectively meet the people in our communities, the people in our areas. Help us as a denomination to be faithful in reaching and training and giving of the resources, the talents, Lord, that you have given to us. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.